You can see because it's very nice, but could you switch on your camera so I can see you, at least some of you, because I'm asking for the PhD students that are attending this course. Thank you. Hi, Bledian. So, let me start the first edition of this course that is dedicated to multi-scale modeling in composites. And the course we feature and we have the honor to host the lecture of Professor Adnan Ibrahimbegovic from the University Tecnologica Campaign, please correct me if I am pronouncing wrong, Adnan. And then Professor Aidas from MIT, University of Melbourne in Australia, and some other colleagues of our university that are Professor Anna Maria Pau, that is present this morning with us from Sapienza, and Maria Laura De Bellis, that is a colleague of the University of Chieti Pescara. And Dr. Nicolas Fantuzzi, that is from the University of Bologna, Alma Mater, and Dr. Marco Pingaro, that is from Sapienza, and Dr. Mela Artuna, that is from the Department of Mechanical Engineering, the Faculty of Engineering of University of Izmit-Arki. Maybe to Meral, I don't know if I report exactly your affiliation, but you, in case you can correct. And this course, as I said, is dedicated to multi-scale modeling composites. I will also investigate the origins of the multi-scale approach in the mechanics of solids and structures. And the various lecturers will tackle different point of view of this very important topic, and I do hope that you enjoy the presentations and the course. And let me start with sharing my screen. Si vede? Si è bloccato. Non so perché si è bloccato. Ok, perfetto. Okay, this is the first lesson of the course, and the title is Multi-field Continua and Multi-scale Methods for the Modeling of Complex Materials. And this is my bio sketch that you can find in the website. And I like to present you the persons of my research group that is titled Multiscale and Multiphysics Modeling for Complex Materials. And some of them will present their deepening and works during this course. And these are the topics that we deal with, and in particular, our maybe they can see, you can see the my mouse.
Yes, all is fine.
Yeah, stop for a moment. Sorry, switch to.
Stiamo registrando. Non ti vede? Non ti vede? Vabbè, mettiamo il PDF adesso, mettiamo il PDF, tanto è uguale, io non ho bisogno del PowerPoint. Se vai qui... Ok. Devi fare stand, hai ragione. Mettiamo il PDF, Marco, perdiamo solo tempo.
Ah, ok.
Non c'è problema. Lasciamo.
Where is the PDF?
Oh.
Ok. Condividi schermo. Zoom.
Non ero già in condivisione. Ok. So I stopped here, and I just wish to say that our main focus is on multiscale modeling on the, and constitutive aspects, and also computational methods for multiscale approach and so on. By using both continua and discrete formulations, and in particular concerning continua formulations, I want to give you some information, some notes concerning non-classical continua formulations. So this is the outline of my lecture. And I want to start from the definition of complex materials and generalized continua, with a mention to the, as I said before, the origins of the continuum discrete formulations. In particular, to highlight the impact of old ideas on current multi-scale modeling. Then I wish to consider some example of scale-dependent continuous models for materials with microstructure. And in the second lesson, I will show you several applications of this kind of approaches for also for discussions with you. And then starting from the definition of complex materials, let me define complex, a material with internal structure and complex constitutive behavior that can be considered as damage, fracture, growth, and so on. And also with internal structure we will describe which kind of internal structure we account for. And it is well known that the multi-scale modeling, considering as an approach for deducting properties and relations at the macroscopic scale by using information derived from proper underlying levels, is a very important and used approach. Generally, this approach will consider the interactions between different scales of descriptions, but in some cases, in particular in mechanics of materials, but also geomechanics, granular media, rocks, and so on, it is sufficient to consider only two scales. And in this case, we deal with a homogenization. The homogenization are procedures that connect conventional micro level description of the material and a continuum macroscopic description. And here you can see different scale, different material with the microstructure at a different scale, and procedure to connect these scales can be considered often the same. And in particular, I wish to focus firstly on discrete to scale dependent continuum theories. And what I mean? I mean that the actual nature of materials, in particular composite complex materials that could be composites in different representations, as I said, at micro, nano, and mesoscale, as for instance Mesory. These kind of materials are discrete and heterogeneous. And interfaces between particles strongly influence the gross behavior. So the macroscopic description must account of the interfaces at the so-called conventional microscopic level. And it is completely certain that a direct discrete modeling of a microstructure can account properly of the features of the microstructure, and is represented some kind of discrete approaches as molecular dynamics, dislocation dynamics, or distinct elements dynamics, and even limit analysis to which we dedicate a lot of attention. But what is not really still known is the possibility to model materials at a macroscopic scale with scale-dependent non-local continuum theories. And in this lecture, I want to focus exactly on this kind of continuum. This is a possibility, this continuum gives a possibility to preserve memory of the microstructure of but resorting to the field equations that characterize any continuum formulations. To have a general framework, I want to define in according to Kunin. I will show you the reference to these sentences in the following. I wish to define non-local according to Kunin. I wish to define non-local materials, so continua, in which we have internal length parameters and spatial dispersion properties in wave propagation. And this means internal length parameters can be, for instance, the size of the elements of the microstructured material. And in wave propagation, I will also show you what we mean for dispersion. Dispersion means propagation of waves with different velocities, and these different velocities produces variation of the amplitude of the and of the shape of the waves, revealing distortion. And distortion is a way to reveal the presence of a internal microstructure. And these are very important feature. This is a very important feature in complex material modeling, in particular in order to avoid some problems as ill conditioning in the field equations and related mesh dependency in the finite elements solutions. And in particular, this kind of non-local representations in terms of continua is necessary when we have the material internal length that becomes comparable to the macroscopic structural length. This is the case in which we need non-local descriptions. And among non-local descriptions, it is useful to distinguish between so-called explicit or strong and implicit or weak non-locality. Explicit or strong non-locality is the most known one, and this is due to Gruner, Ehrlichman, and is related to the definition, as is well known, of the stress, the definition of the stress, that is a non-local definition. The stress depends not only on the point in which we evaluate this measure, but also on the values on convenient neighboring. And Dr. Meraltuna will present in his seminar some deepenings of this kind of approach tomorrow. While implicit or weak non-locality can be referred to continua with additional degrees of freedom. We have a large variety of this kind of continua. This kind of continua, as you can see in the slide, can be called generalized continua, non-classical, non-simple continua because they are of greater than one. And another term is microcontinua, and I like to use multi-field continua because it refers to the presence of extra degrees of freedom with respect to the standard one. This means that a material point can have displacements as in the standard continuum description, and some other kind of descriptors representing, of course, the microstructure. And this definition is due always to Conin, and is also proposed by Mongin and by Eringen, and I will show you the references hereafter. I use this kind of formulation because for me is convincing. So, concerning extra degrees of freedom, the case that I call weak or implicit non-locality, you can refer to the physical microstructure, for instance, that are the size of the heterogeneity. For example, for solid with defects, dislocations, inclinations, as in this picture that are shown in this slide, or porous media and liquid crystal, and so on. But also to geometrical microstructure in reduced dimension models, as it occurs, for instance, in a Timoshenko beam. You know that a Timoshenko beam is a one-dimensional model in which we consider the presence of the third dimension, the other dimensions, with the addition of kinematical degrees of freedom. In that case, this additional degrees of freedom is the rotation of a section that can be called a micro-rotation by considering this other kind of continua that I will show you right now. In any case, you don't have a model with the points that can only translate, but you have a model with the points that can translate and rotate. And rotation is additional degrees of freedom. This is a retrospective, a bibliographic retrospective of multi-field microcontinua or multi-field continua. Decide which is the terms that you prefer. Generalized continua is the same. And we can start. I like to start by presenting the works of Voigt at the beginning of 20th century, because before the well-known Cosserat treatise of Cosserat brothers, in my knowledge, is the first model, is the first formulation in which particle rotations appear. Particle rotations and work conjugated couple interactions. And then we have in the contemporary era the important contribution of the basics of continuum mechanics of Erikson and Trussell. And also in this case, in this treatise and these articles, you can find the attempt to bypass the dimensional limits of one or two dimensional models, and in order to reproduce a three-dimensional behavior. In the work of Trussell and Tupin that is mentioned here, you can find the concept of generalized velocities and corresponding, in the sense of the works expanded, generalized stresses. And there is a first formulation of a general, there is a general formulation of the virtual work theorem. Then we have some other important works of Italian mathematicians, Grioli, who presented the hyperelastic materials with strain energy depending on first and higher order deformation gradient, as in the paper of Tupin. And then the Deutsch school is strictly related to the matter physics point of view and introduced this additional degrees of freedom to this related to these locations. Then we have the important works of Mindlin on coupled stress and Tupin also on coupled stress. I will be more precise in the following. And what is very interesting is to recognize that in this description we have a point which is a structured point. I like to call a structured molecule, and this will be clear in the following, but it's a point with a microstructure in the attached. The Mindlin model is also a hyperelastic model, it can be reconducted to the formulation that I presented before of Trussell and Tupin, who consider the material points with attached a triad of deformable directors. And when these directors are rigid, the model corresponds to the micropolar model or Cosserat model, well known as a Cosserat model. We also have basic works of 60s and 70s by many authors, also Eringen, and I do suggest to everyone who is interested on this kind of continuous formulation to refer to the book of Eringen, Microcontinuum Field Theories, here mentioned. And also the work of Kunin that I already mentioned, in which you can find material with internal length scale parameter that are connected with geometry, that is the size of the microstructure, but also to long-range interaction forces. And Dr. Kuna will explain this point of view. And of course, they introduce the non-local elasticity to which we want to devote much attention. And then we also have the works of Green and Rivlin, Green and Nagy, and there is no limit to to the conceivement of this kind of materials. But what I think is that these are very powerful formulations, but they can work, and then they can be used only if we have a constitutive theory that support these formulations. And this is why, even if the coserate work was rediscovered about 60s and 70s, this was not longer used till now. But at the moment, we think that provided with a constitutive theory and exploiting the advantages of multiscale approaches, these can be theories applicable, and I will show you some possibilities with the help of my collaborators. Finally, I want to also refer to the works that can be considered generated to the work of Ashelby on these continuities and the important work of Capritz, and I do suggest to consider this paper, this book, to deepen the knowledge on continua with the microstructure with a general point of view, and the book of Gertin that is dedicated to the models of configurational forces that I will show also briefly in the following. Then we have paper by Capritz. Gianfranco Capritz is an Italian academician of Lincei and a very important scholar that study continuum mechanics since many years, and also Podio Guidugli. The microstructure in this kind of continua has not only kinematical character, but can represent different kind of descriptors, and I will show you something. And this is, in a sense, justify the definition of multi-field continua. Then, just to have a schematic framework, and for those who want to deepen this topic, we can, of course, discuss in a different situation. You can consider micro continuum field theories, both linear and non-linear from a kinematical point of view, that differ by the classical field theories by the fact that each material particle, as I said, is endowed with additional degrees of freedom, representing, for instance, the material microstructure. So a microcontinuum can be considered as a collection of deformable particles that can be named subcontinua. These deformable particles undergo macro and micro motions. Here there is, as I said, the schematic of this formulation. X is the position that a material point occupies in the Euclidean space, and the additional and xi are the additional parameters which describe the microstructure. So, these parameters are more than one, and alpha is the number of the order parameters, say additional degrees of freedom, that represent a complete placement following the definition of Capritz of the inner structure. And this can be scalar, vector field, tensor field, and so on. It depends, of course, on the effectiveness of the description. So, the microcontinuum is a collection of deformable particles, and this picture is compatible with the classical picture of a material point endowed with the physical properties, as mass density, electric field, and other properties. So the terms multi-field. And provided, as I want to stress again, that provided by constitutive theories, for instance, exploiting the multi-scale approach, they can be useful to grossly describe solid composites, porous media, and many other kinds of materials. The microcontinua, or continua with microstructure, or generalized multi-field continua, and so on, can undergo macro and micro deformation, as represented in this slide. And correspondingly, we have macro and micro transplacement gradient. And also, we can define macro and micro strain. I think that is not very well known is that if we define the rigid motion for this kind of continua, in the correspondence of a rigid motion, the stress measures defined are null. And this is important to observe because another kind of generalized continua, as continua with configuration of forces, this is not true. We can define a rigid motion and verify that the stress measures are not null. I will present you in the following a model for a paper, for a model for a material with pores, and the model with a, of a material with pores will present this kind of strain measures that remain non-null during the under the rigid motion. Coming back to the multi-field continua, the micromorphic continua. We can look at this slide. We have this continua as a collection of subcontinua. And this subcontinua can undergo different displacements. In this case, I consider the standard displacement with the term U, and U1 the additional displacement, micro displacement. In this case, the theory is a theory with one order parameter. And as I said before, this parameter can be more than one. When the parameter is only one and the corresponding gradients, the model can be named micromorphic. And we can consider macro and micro displacements and gradients, of course. And just to have an idea, in this micromorphic model, you can associate to the material point a triad of deformable directions, as Erickson and Trussell proposed. And we can have a hierarchy inside this description. And we can obtain, for instance, a microstructure model in which the additional parameter, this is phi, but consider that this can correspond to the gradient of the micro displacement. In this case, the microstructure model, in the case of a microstructure model, phi correspond to a spheric deformation plus a rotation that is named microstretch. Then we can have the second gradient model in which phi correspond exactly to the gradient of the standard displacement. than the micropolar model, in which we have the displacement U, the gradient of the macro displacement. The macro displacement, the gradient of the micro displacement, and the additional descriptor that is a rotation. Here, W is a skew-symmetric tensor that represents a rigid rotation. And if we want to refer to the description of Erikson and Trusdell, with the deformable directors are in this case rigid. We can also consider the as a subcase of the micropolar continuum couple stress continua. Ma Marco, io posso togliere le viste perché loro vedono male queste come lo vedo male io. Perché dà fastidio. Couple stress, in which we have the rotations, that is the rotations of the particle, which corresponds to the so-called local rigid rotation of a continuum model, the so-called macro rotation. So, name WV, the micro rotation, and the skew symmetric part of the gradient of macro displacement as macro rotation. Note also that the displacement in this case is considered in a linearized theory, so it corresponds to a velocity. Then we can have as a subcase in this hierarchy the classical model in which no directors appear. These are the strain and the stress measures of a macromorphic continuum. And in this case, you can consider the macro, relative, and micro measures. In this table, both kinematic and dynamic descriptors are reported. And in the case of the micromorphic model, as I said before, we have the macro displacement and I missed here the subscribe one, but we have the gradient. Here there is a mistake that I want to correct, but this is the gradient of the macro displacement and this is the gradient of the micro displacement. This is the inner work density formula in which the non-classical terms are underlined in yellow. And here this parameter alpha depends only on the representation of the tensors of strain and stress and does not particular meaning, no mechanical meaning. And we can consider as T the symmetric part of the stress, so the Cauchy stress, and A the skew symmetric part of the stress. And these are additional stress and strain measures. What is important to focus, without entering too much details, is the presence of the so-called relative measure, for instance, relative strain measures. That is the difference between the gradient of the macro displacement and the gradient of the micro displacement. And this measure, in represented in green, spans work with the skew symmetric part of the stress. And we will see that this is very important when we consider, for instance, anisotropic materials. And we can also highlight that this measure is null, is not null, only in the micropolar model. And this means that only the micropolar model, as we will see after, is able to represent the orthotrochic behavior of materials. Just an anticipation, you can think a material like Messori. A Messori is orthotropic, and in the micropolar model, as we will see, we have non-symmetric stress and non-symmetric strains. And the relative rotation, that is the difference between the macro rotation, so the skew symmetric part of the gradient of macro displacement, and the micro rotation, that is the additional degree of freedom of a micropolar model, this difference corresponds to the skew symmetric part of the strain. Then, if the skew symmetric part of the strain is prominent, this cannot be, this cannot be of course neglected. And in a medium like Messori, in which it is easy to recognize that the strains are not symmetric, as the strains are different with respect to different orthogonal planes. This means that orthotropic materials are better represented by a micropolar model, where, of course, as I said, the relative rotation is not null. In all the other models that are micromorphic models that I presented, this measure, strain measure, is null, and correspondingly the stress measure work conjugated. This is the case of the second gradient model. So let's consider the generalized version of the virtual work theorem for deriving the balance equations of micromorphic model. Here we have the representation of the internal work and the representation of the external work, and just applying the divergence theorem, Green's theorem, after some steps, mathematical steps, we can derive the balance equations. These balance equations can be also derived using the null axioms of Galilean and the Eulerian invariants, but I prefer to use the approach of virtual work, and this will be clear, I hope will be clear in the following. But in this case, we can derive this the balance equation, the linear moment equation of macro forces, and the moment balance equations, that is represented here. This generalized version of the standard balance equation, in which, as you can see, the skew symmetric part of the stress will appear in the moment equation. And also the structure of the attractions can be derived univocally. Just to give an example, this is the case of a second gradient model. A second gradient model in which the balance equation that we can derive depends on the use of the divergence theorem. In this case, for instance, the second gradient, we have the second gradient formulation of the second gradient of the displacement u, that is the macro displacement, is divided into a surface part and a part that is normal to the surface. So by applying this the divergence theorem as a surface divergence theorem, and by considering this the expression of the external works, so the colors correspond to the terms to that can be compared to derive the balance equations. The terms K is a term that corresponds to the trace of the curvature tensor. We can derive the momentum balance law, that is the so-called macro balance equations, referred to the bulk balance equations, linear momentum balance, and another equations that define the structure of the tractions. And in this case, we can deal with diffused tractions, standard, and diffused micro tractions, here called hyper traction. This is the approach proposed by Tupin and then more recently by Fried and Gertin. And you can see that the tractions on the surface of the body depends on the curvature. I will also focus on this aspect in the following. Another possibility to consider the divergence theorem is to consider also the distribution of the forces along a line, not only surfaces. And I can give you a paper that I brought with my colleague Anna Maria Pau by applying these two kinds of descriptions for second gradient models. But at the moment, I just want to show that using this kind of possibility for the divergence theorem by considering the so-called edge terms, so distribution along a line, we can find different kind of balance equations. The first one is the bulk balance equation that holds in the whole interior of the body by excluding only the boundary. And these are the tractions on the boundary that are diffused traction, so the macro tractions, diffused hypertractions, and we can also call them hypertractions, and concentrated hypertractions along the line. And this is the approach of Podio Guidugli and Pianello. Finally, we can have the micropolar model in which we consider the expression of the internal and of the external work, and also by resorting to the divergence theorem we derive the bulk linear moment equation and bulk angular moment equations. And also in this case, it appears the terms that in the other slides I called A, that is the skew symmetric part of the stress. In this equation, I missed, neglected the effect of body couple while we have the body forces. But in case we can just add a term that is a tensorial term which represents the body couple. And the structure of the attractions, diffused attractions, that are the standard attractions, and diffused hyperattractions, that in this case are moment, because the model is a micropolar. Oh, in this light, I just want to consider the continuum that I called with the configuration of forces. Also in this case, we have a standard continuum in which we have the macro displacement and the gradient of a micro displacement and the corresponding stress. And this is the so-called Cauchy theory of grade 1, also named simple continuum. Complex continuum is a term that Poggio Guidulli used, and I reported this because it's different from simple, and in this case we have a number of order parameters, as in the description of Caprix that I recalled, different displacement descriptors, but consider that they can be also not kinematical descriptors. For the sake of simplicity, I call them the additional displacements, but we can consider also different kind of descriptors. And all the gradients of the additional fields introduced. So we can have, for instance, continue with the scalar microstructure, in which the additional field is a scalar field with a fixed direction, privileged microstructure direction. We can have continue with the vectorial microstructure. This is a matter of representation, and the microstructure is represented U1 with a vector field, and a continuum with the tensorial affine microstructure, and within this continuum we can also include micromorphic continuum. I just want to focus on the important peculiar features of this kind of continua, which properly represent the microstructure, with a sort of naive description that I hope can help in focusing the more relevant aspects. The first one, as we said a lot of times, there are more descriptors than velocity, that is the infinitesimal displacements in the linearized description, and more strain measures were conjugated to more stress measures, the parameters and their gradients. Then, as already shown, for micromorphic continua, also in this case, there are additional balance equations that can be interpreted as constitutive prescriptions. I don't want to focus now on this definition because I will do it in the following. These are the balance equations derived from the application of a generalized version of the virtual work principle. And just to say, these balance equations cannot be derived by using the standard axiom of variance by null, because the equations of the macro forces, that is the standard balance equation of forces, can be derived also with the null invariance in terms of Galilean change of frames, but the equations called of the micro forces cannot be derived with the standard invariance, because normally the additional descriptors that we introduce are not Galilean invariant. For instance, if you consider, as we will, I will show in the following examples, additional descriptors that is a relative displacement, like it can occur in a pore or on a crack. This displacement is a relative displacement, and this is not Galilean invariant. So the equations of the microforces cannot be derived using the standard invariance axioms. While using the virtual work theorem, we can derive all the equations of equilibrium. Then there are mutual interactions between separate parts of different type, or self-interactions. And as a consequence, the geometry of a shape boundary enters the boundary conditions not only through the normal vector to the boundary. Let's see this picture. I am not a mathematician, but this is convincing naive representation of this idea, that is, that the mutual interactions and then the tractions in the continuum do not depend only on the normal to the surface as in the classical Cauchy grade 1 model. So in the first case of this picture, you can see the so-called defined codimension, and the codimension is the difference between the dimension of the Euclidean space and the dimension of the in this case manifold, but the dimension of the object in which the tractions act, in this case of the classical continuum, for instance a surface, and the results 3 minus 2 is 1. The theory is of grade 1. In a theory of grade 2, you can see that this difference is 3 minus 1, and the tractions are distributed along a line, as we saw in the second gradient model. And in this case, I already quickly mentioned that the tractions are not only depending on the normal to the surface, like a classical Cauchy continuum, but also on the curvature. And here is reported with this stress tensor K, that is the curvature tensor. Also, more, we have a theory of grade 3 in the case in which this difference is 3 minus 3 is equal to 0. And tractions are concentrated even in a point. We also have, and this is a model that I use, I often use also with my colleague Anna Maria Pau, is a theory of grade 0, And in this case, this difference is 3 minus 0, and we have the internal actions that are distributed to the volume, on the volume. Finally, we have, as in the micromorphic model of indeed, intrinsic length scales in the field equations. And this implies, as I said before, no Hill conditioning in the field equations, no mesh dependence in the finite element solutions. There is a sentence that is missed, but I will add before giving you these slides. Another condition is that these kind of models are intrinsically thermodynamic compatible. And this means that we can define, for instance, a free energy. A free energy depending on the gradient of the macro displacement, on the micro displacement directly, and the gradient of micro displacement. And we can insert this in the local, a generalized version, the local dissipation inequality, Clausius Duhem kind, and identify all the stress measures that are work conjugated to the all these strain measures of the model. This is not true for standard grade 2, for instance, internal variables models, because in this case, in the dissipation inequalities, we have to add some dissipation work. This is something that happens in, for instance, in plasticity when we consider the so-called Drucker postulate. In the case of multi-field continua, both of the micromorphic kind and both of configuration kind, the problem of thermodynamic compatibility is naturally intrinsically satisfied by assuming with respect to the internal variable models that are models in which we also add to the classical continua additional variables representing in some kind the microstructure. We have additional variables that are observable and obey to specific balance law. We don't have to add kinetics, any kinetics. They are intrinsically thermodynamically compatible. The internal power is not null under rigid motion, only in the case of configurational forces model. And this is the difference between micromorphic and configurational forces models. Because in the micromorphic continua, in the rigid motions, these strain measures are null. And configurational forces are needed to describe the material internal structure. And by definition, they are implicitly non-local. So by concluding this first part dedicated to a very, very quick overview on the world of generalized continua that are non-local continua, scale-dependent continuum theories, we can synthesize that we have internal lengths, spatial dispersion in wave propagation, and thermodynamic compatibility. This implies, as I said, a well-posed problem to solve, and no mesh dependence, that is more important, consequently, in numerical formulations. Concerning thermodynamic compatibility, we don't need additional dissipation inequalities in the formulations. And providing that we are able to perform a multi-scale procedure for deriving the constitutive characterization of these strange materials, I think that we can make sense to the nonsense of generalized continuum. And we can use both kind of implicit weak non-locality or explicit or strong non-locality. I think that we can stop for a couple of minutes, 5 minutes, and then I can start with the second part of the talk. Could you hear me? I cannot see you. Just to have a small, very small break.
Yeah, sure.
Marco, non c'è più? Marco? È vivo? No, che faccio? Esco da qui un attimo. Però non ce l'ho, cioè, scusate, io sono un boomer, come I am a boomer as my son likes to define me, and that means incapable to use technology.
All is fine, go ahead, yeah, all fine.
Ok. Allora, adesso prendo, scusa, mi prendo un altro PDF, secondo me. Ah no, è lo stesso, non devo chiuderlo, è lo stesso, Marco, sta rimango là. Okay, you can see my screen.
Yes, we can.
So, I want to say to you that what I wanted to do is to give a general framework for orientating within the world of generalized continuum. Of course, for whose are not familiar with this topic, it could be a little bit complicated in entering into details, but I will give you all the slides, and if one of you is interested in deepening or also in details, we can arrange or another dedicated lesson only to the details, or I can give you other material, other further stuff. But what is very important for me is to give this framework in a general way, because it's a very variegated, complicated world, and for me it is important to fix some basic, very basic important idea, as for instance idea of non-locality, that is the presence of internal length in the field equations and dispersion properties in wave propagations. These are important features to avoid problems, well-known problems of ill conditioning in the formulation and corresponding mesh dependency in finite element descriptions. So, in the second part of this lecture, I want to mention, to give a glance to the 19th century original discrete continuum models, highlight the impact, as I said before, of all the ideas on current multiscale modeling. And I like to refer to a sentence of Elias Aifantis that is, all the ideas for new models across materials, processes and case scales. And this is the title of a symposium he organized many years ago in Mexico, 2014, dedicated to a Nobel laureate, Dan Schechtman, that works on materials, periodic quasi crystals with symmetries. And this approach is finalized to the investigation of the origins of multiscale modeling, indeed, for deriving suggestions for the modeling of a new complex materials that are, let me remember, materials with internal lengths and internal microstructure. This in order to find conceptual guidelines for deriving discrete to scale dependent continua that can be non-local, non-classical continua in the meaning that I briefly recalled before. In this slide are resumed different approaches, different kind of approaches of homogenization, coarse graining procedure. Coarse graining is a term that is often used in matter physics. In mechanical engineering, we also use the term homogenization. And continua derived from lattices. The homogenization approaches is a multi-scale approach, as I said before, that connect only two scales of descriptions, macroscopic scale and the macroscopic scale, that is the continuum one. And are developed within the framework of standard, classical, and non-standard, generalized, continua, micro-continua, multi-field continua, and so on. The average approaches are basically based on the solution on boundary value problems, on a micro model, and in particular on a representative volume element of the micro model, as we will see in the lessons of tomorrow and in the other contribution of the other authors, other lecturers in this course. And derive macroscopic properties that are constitutive properties, both for Cauchy classical and non-classical continua. We often deal with the micropolar continua, and I will show you some details concerning homogenization with the micropolar continua. But now I want to focus on the so-called continua derived from lattices. So, these are models based on lattice mechanics and exploit energy equivalence. This means that a priori kinematical, generally kinematical maps are posed, a kinematical map between the large degrees of freedom of a discrete model and the continuum fields, for instance, kinematical fields. And using this map that in the literature is known as Cauchy-Born rule, we are able to derive macroscopic equations, as we will see, and the constitutive characterization also for micropolar continua and continua with configurational forces that are continua with additional degrees of freedom, that is non-local continua of implicit kind. And this approach can be reconducted to the original molecular theory of elasticity developed by Navier, Cauchy, and Poisson. Note that multi-scale strategies now, as in the past, allow us to identify relationships among different material scales in order to derive macroscopic constitutive functions for materials with internal structure. And at the beginnings, analogous strategies were developed for describing the behavior of elastic material. And aims of the theory, the molecular theory of elasticity, was to derive the field equations of a material body basing on the definition of microscopic laws for molecular atomic interactions depending on the intermolecular distance. Macroscopic quantities then, as stress, elastic moduli, etc., are derived as a result of average on the molecular material quantities. And these molecular models in the classical formulations of Cauchy and also Navier were model made of point-like particles that they called molecules interacting in pair through forces directed along the line connecting their centers and depending on the mutual distance. This is the so-called central force scheme introduced by Cauchy. And note that the molecule, the concept of molecules, is referred to material point, essentially, inside which no forces are accounted for, or, if present, are of lower order of magnitude of the intermolecular forces. And we will see when this concept of molecules was enhanced to consider also the microstructure. And this is the idea that I consider very important to describe materials, to actually describe materials. Just to remember, as a historical epistemological introduction, this theory was introduced in order to justify the causes of elasticity, because they are searching for the causes, which were presumed to stem from the natural attractive or repulsive properties of elementary particles, as the molecules, and depending, of course, on their mutual distance, as in the original idea of Newton, specified later by other like Boscovich, Coulomb, etc. And the mechanistic perspective of the molecular model of elasticity was much appreciated by the scientists of the period, and among these, Saint Venant, who you know represented the basic work of Navier with the addition of very important notes in 1864, mostly because it preserved the Newtonian interpretation of internal forces as interactions between material particles. Worth to remember that in the Newton program, the basic intent of reducing all natural phenomena to forces of attraction and repulsion, this is a page of the treatise of Newton on optics, and this famous case 31, in which he called he deals with the so-called elective attractions, which in his interpretation represents elasticity. And this records the purpose of classical science of reproducing the apparent complexity of natural phenomena by simple principles. But I don't want to enter into details, but I want just to focus on the idea that in the case of Newton, these attractive forces, elective attractions, did not need of the matter. This was at the distance forces. While for the scientists of 19th century, they need to insert a medium. Note that this interpretation of Newton also solicited studies of chemistry on chemistry and also in the literature with the well-known book on elective attractions of Goethe. Anyway, as I said, the mechanicians of 19th century needed to consider a medium among the particles. And here you can find some important treatises that are also earlier than the treatise of 19th century, but the idea was always the same. Elasticity is a matter coherence due to the presence of attracting forces between particles. And they needed to introduce a substance, a matter called gluten, fluid, and other ways like the ether in thermodynamics, but this is not really important as for us we know that there is no need of medium to define interactions between particles, but in our current interpretation there is no need to refer to the causes of elasticity. We can define the forces as interactions between particles. And in the Cauchy central force model, these forces are these forces depends only on the distance between two particles. Here it is possible also to follow the steps, but it's not necessary to enter into this detail if you are not interested. As before, I want to focus on the idea that underlined these formulations and the idea, of course, to those who are interested, I can say I can give many articles with details, and I will put this in a folder to share with you. But now I want to focus on the idea. That is idea, basic idea of homogenization. And this what is called the Cauchy-Born rule, that in metaphysics is often used, is the definition of a one-to-one correspondence map between the discrete degrees of freedom and the continuum displacement field. When this map is homogeneous, that is of the first order, you can see here only the first gradient of displacement present, the model is called a local model. Otherwise, we can use the refined description with higher order gradients and also derive, using this correspondence map, a continuum description. But focus on the case of local model, as the Cauchy model finally was a local model. These are the constitutive equations that he derived. Sometimes and disappeared. I don't know why in this representation. Anyway, you can consider that the forces into the Cauchy molecular model are, as I said before, the average of the interactions between molecules. And this is a sum over a not really specified, but a control volume element that stands for the representative volume elements that in current theory is defined, for instance, for periodic materials or materials with at least statistically homogeneous. And from this average of quantities of internal forces, it is possible to define a stress tensor. And this is a standard representation of tensor algebra of the Cauchy stress. And finally, the constitutive tensor. Also, in this case, I can give you details if you are interested in the derivation of Cauchy equations transliterated in terms of modern current terzo algebra, because in the original papers of Cauchy, there was a language that is, of course, different from the one that I am representing in these slides. Which is the key point? In the Cauchy model, the constitutive parameters of an isotropic, general anisotropic description are 15. That you, all of you know that the coefficients in elasticity, anisotropic elasticity, are 21. And this kind of theory is called Rari constant theory, that is opposite to the standard multi-constant theory with 21 coefficients. And what does it mean? Means that also in the case of different material symmetries, the constants are less than the required ones. For this, 6 in the orthotropy and 1, only 1 in the case of isotropy instead of course, two constants. And this is a problem that is well known in matter physics, as they derive constitutive relations of continua starting from lattice description, so discrete descriptions. And in the case in which they consider triangular lattices, this means is corresponding to a model of truss-like. This corresponds to a truss-like models. And in a truss-like models, of course, you have the nodes that interact with the forces that are directed only along the line connecting the points. This is a different model of, for instance, a beam-like model in which the particles interact through forces directed along the line connecting the points, the nodes, and moments, shear and moments. In the case of triangular lattices, we are exactly in the formulation, the central force formulation of Cauchy. And what was the problem? The problem was that in that case, the evaluation of the Poisson coefficient was univocally defined as 1, 2, up to 4. That is not true in the reality. This led to various experimental discrepancies because in those years many experiments were performed, and of course this approach of Cauchy was abandoned because of the experimental discrepancies concerning the evaluation of the Poisson coefficient. But some years after, both Voldemar Voigt, then Henri Poincaré, proposed some refinements to the Cauchy molecular model that was neglected by the literature, the following literature, but that I want to present you, and I have also in this case many papers dedicated to this question. Both Voigt and Poincaré introduced the refinements that allow to bypass the discrepancy related to the local central force scheme. And what I want to show you is that these refinements in both cases are refinements that define non-local models. So the approach is always mechanistic, as in the Cauchy and Poisson models in Navier. But the model that can be derived are essentially non-local, and we will see in which way. And I want to show this because this is the idea that to which we can refer when constructing a constitutive theory for a material with microstructure. The idea, as I said before, of a structured molecule that is a point endowed by microstructure. So just to enter quickly enter in the representation of Voigt. Voldemar Voigt has a basic knowledge in crystallography. The works of Bravais was of the same years in which Voigt worked, and he demonstrated that the Navier-Cauchy molecular theory failed only because it assumed a central force scheme, depending only on mutual distance and not, for instance, on the orientations of particles. Note that the concept of moment was not really clear. This is the first formulation in my knowledge is by Poinsot, 1834. Then Lord Kelvin, 1867. Then we have the treatise of Cosserat, but in the next century. When Voigt presented his first work was in 1887, and the model of Voigt was a model based, there was theory of potential growing in, at this time, model in which he introduced the potential function of particles interacting in pair through forces and moment, like a system of rigid bodies. And this allowed him to derive, always by considering the sum over a representative control volume of the interactions, that was both forces and couples. Then, as the goal was to define Cauchy model, because Cauchy was a mathematician that was very important at that time, and his formulation was the formulation to the benchmark formulation. So, to reproduce the Cauchy model, Voigt introduced a constraint, an internal constraint, that is, a kinematical constraint. For which, in a representative control volume that he called the molecular sphere of action, considered only the rotation of the particles all equal. The particles are uniformly oriented within the so-called molecular sphere of action. And this allow him to derive a Cauchy model with the necessary 21 elasticities in the case of anisotropy, and of course two elasticities, two elastic constants in the case of isotropy. And this is very important because the approach is the same. It's an approach based on the mechanical description of Lattice model. And you to have an idea, you can refer to a model, a framework of beams connected together, which transmit both forces and couples. So, truss-like systems produces a Cauchy local central force scheme, and beam-like systems produces a molecular Cosserat model. Then, by putting this constraint, all the molecules undergo the same rotation, and this constraint, also using constitutive considerations, the couple between these two molecules are null, and the Cauchy model is derived, but with the right number of elasticities. On the other kind, at the same time, Henri Poincaré proposed a molecular approach in elasticity, introducing a so-called, in current terms, multi-body potentials, also bypassing the problem of the identification of the correct number of material constants. This is 1892. And in the model of Poincaré, also a potential function is introduced, but in his model, the potential functions depend not only on pair interactions, but also on triplets, interactions by triplets or even more particles. And it can possible to demonstrate that this also produces a model that is non-local in the sense defined before. When the interactions among triplets are neglected, he obtained as a subcase the Cauchy central force scheme. These are some details in which I don't want to enter, but it is important to highlight that in the second order term of the potential, there is a term depending on the interactions in pair, and that term depending on the interactions by triplets. And even in this case, a kinematical map. And this means homogenization, coarse graining procedure with a Cauchy-Born rule, connecting the discrete degrees of freedom with the continuum ones, is also proposed. And this is a tensorial representation, but the formula is the same. And this homogeneous map. Homogeneous map means that only the first gradient appears, as in the linearized Cauchy rule. And in this case, by dividing the terms corresponding to the two-body interactions and to the three-body interactions, we can demonstrate that the constants are 21. As required by the theory of elasticity in the case of anisotropy, while in the case of isotropy, these constants become two, the needed two. In the first term, we can recognize that there are the so-called Cauchy-Poisson relations, that are six relations, and introducing these relations. That is, by neglecting the three-body term, the constants became 15, as in the Cauchy model. So, when the model is local, as to have a simple idea, a truss-like system, you have a Cauchy model as a continuum, a natural description of continuum, with this kind of procedure. And when the model is a beam-like model, the description is non-local, a non-local one. So, to remove the local character of the description due to the Cauchy assumptions that here I report, point-like particles interacting in pair depending on their mutual distance, that is the so-called central force scheme, and homogeneous lattice continuum deformations, that is the Cauchy-Born rule as a local action, physicians call it harmonic approximations, depending only on the first gradient of description. By removing one of these hypotheses, the description becomes non-local. Both Foyt and Poincaré used both Foyt and Poincaré removed the first hypothesis. The scheme is not a central force scheme. Foyt, by introducing rigid bodies in the description, the molecules, structured molecules, are rigid bodies interacting through forces and couples. And Poincaré, by introducing three body interactions. In both cases, we have angular potentials, because by the cosines, you can consider that the triplets represents the case of rigid bodies interactions. But what is important to recognize that in both models, there is internal length, and the descriptions are non-local. Then, Foyt insert the internal constraints that all the particles rotate in the same way, and this in terms of the continua that I presented before means that the local rigid rotation, that is the so-called macro rotation, that is the skew symmetric part of the gradient of displacement, correspond to the macro rotation. In the discrete reference, all the particles rotate of the same quantities, like an Akoshi continuum. With this constraint, the description can be reduced to with 21 constants. Poincaré, at the same time, introduced the ones that I called Cauchy-Poisson relations, and also in this case, his model can be reconducted to the classical model. But this is a classical model with the necessary number of constants required. Note that many scientists of the 19th century participated actively to the debate about the molecular theory of elasticity developed by Navier, Cauchy, and Poisson. And this theory was longer supported by Saint-Venant, mostly for this mechanical background, recalling the works of Newton and others. But even if Voigt and Poincaré offered a good solution to this controversy, the molecular approach was definitively abandoned in favor of the purely mathematic potential theory by Green that is studied in our standard courses. The theory of potential by Green, based on the mathematical assumption that the internal work of any force system is an exact differential, were confirmed by the experiment and were definitively adopted in elasticity. This theory is called the multi-constant theory. But what I want to highlight is that the Foyt and Poincaré, but also of Cauchy, mechanistic interpretation could be useful when we have to describe a material microstructure like a composite materials. Because in this case, differently than an ideal material like iron or other materials in which an expression of the potential energy as a quadratic form of the strain tensor can be given, in a material with a microstructure, it's more difficult to find an expression for the potential energy from which derive all the constitutive terms. So this is, in my opinion, it is more convincing to start from the description at the conventional microscopic level that could be a nano level, a micro level, or even a meso level like in a mesory, define the interactions, use these relations, equivalence relations in the micro model, and derive the constitutive terms that are needed just by enriching the microscopic description with structured molecules. That is, molecules with some additional descriptors. At present, multi-scale techniques allowing the derivation of macroscopic models for complex materials by defining direct links with lattice systems are still among promising approaches in material science, as I said. And current researches in solid-state physics as well in mechanics of materials show that the energy equivalent continua obtained by building proper particle interactions potentials allow us to describe various kinds of microstructures at different length scales, nano, micro, meso, and material behaviors, not only linear. And this is a general representation of the Cauchy-Born rule that is standardly used in crystal elasticity. And this is the standard expression of the pain potential function. This is the first Piola stress tensor, and this is the Lagrangian tangent stiffness tensor. But let me stress this point. Non-local descriptions can be derived from lattices, and not very differently than in the past, in current atomistic modeling, as well as in mechanics of composite materials, there are many circumstances in which the inadequacies of Cauchy hypothesis, here recalled, central force scheme, and homogeneous deformation, first order, first gradient of displacement, linearized Cauchy-Born rule, calls for the need of improved, for instance, hyperelastic, discrete models for bypassing experimental discrepancies related to phenomena dominated by the microstructure size. This occurs in plasticity, damage, fracture, for instance, to deal with the problems of strain localization, but also in elasticity, as we will see in the next lecture, as a stress concentration in the presence of geometrical or load singularities, like cracks, holes, inclusions, and so on. And, of course, the case of concentrated loads. So, removing the central force scheme, we can obtain multi-field theory that are, as I said before, implicitly or weakly non-local, as did by Foyt or Poincaré. Or we can remove the hypothesis of a homogeneous deformation and obtain, in this case, higher order theories, like non-convex energy models that are widely used in elasticity and not only elasticity. Obtaining, in that case, explicit strong non-localities. So, in both cases of implicit weak non-locality or explicit strong non-locality, the important feature for describing microstructure without encountering problems of Hill conditioning in the field equations and mesh dependency in the finite element formulations, for instance, are present. And these are internal lengths in the field equations, spatial dispersions, and thermodynamic compatibility. These are some references on the Mueller theory of elasticity, And below some paper that I dedicated to this topic. In particular, I can suggest this one, that is Genesis of the Multiscale Approach for Materials with Microstructure, the Archive of Applied Mechanics, 2009, but also Foyt and Poincaré Mechanistic Dielectric Approaches to Linear Elasticity and Suggestions for Multiscale Modeling, always in Archive of Applied Mechanics of 2011. And also a paper on the Archive of History of Exact Science on the same topic. But in the papers on Archive of Applied Mechanics, what is presented is not only a philological interpretation of the works of Foyt and Poincaré, but is the interpretations as Aiphantis said in the sentence of Aiphantis that I mentioned before, is a derivation of idea for building a constitutive theory for complex materials. These are some other references concerning non-local continua derived from lattices. And I want to conclude by observing that by building a multi-scale constitutive theory, a reinterpretation of the Foyt, for instance, mechanistic molecular approach, suggests that microscopic phenomenology can be interpreted and rationalized by microscopic information. Once selected a phenomenological model and constructed an energy function, the corresponding continuum micromodel can be defined. And it can be demonstrated that this continuum, if the lattice model is refined with some ingredients, is in general multi-field continuum, that is a continuum with additional degrees of freedom. And my difficulties in this case are related to the definition of the phenomenological micromodels and recent developments of experimental techniques can help in obtaining this kind of definition. And according to Erikson sentence, a constitutive equation produced from a plausible model is by one interpretation physically reasonable. And the Erikson that I mentioned here is the book dedicated to the molecular theory of elasticity. And some of the notes that I presented are resumed in these books, and in particular in the paper in the book, Springer book, that I edited and where I also wrote a paper. And I think that for today we can stop the presentation here. And in case you are not too much bored, I was happy to ask to listen for some questions by you, also by the people that are in the room.
Can professors ask question? Is that okay? Is it
Ecco.
okay? Do you hear me, Patricia?
Sì, ti vedo. Yes, I
Thanks.
can see you.
Perfect. First, I would like to thank you for choosing these lectures because they were perfect complement to what I'm going to talk about. I think it's really the wealth of the courses like this that PhD students can get all possible type of approaches. And in fact, I do mention, but very briefly, the approach of Constera that you presented in very much detail and very nicely, very perfectly.
This afternoon.
I'm glad that Italian professors admire French professors and vice versa, the other way. And then also, I like your non-local theory presentation, all these things. But
Sorry, can you hear him in the room? Sorry, Adnan, because I have the maximum of the
I would just, Patricia, anyway, the compliments are for you, Patricia. The compliments.
Sorry, Adnan, just for the people that are in the room, because they cannot hear you very well. Marco, si può fare qualcosa?
Yes,
No.
then
If
I'm
you
still in
can,
my.
if
I'm
you
still
can
in.
hide your volume, or maybe you can come. Approach.
Yeah, I'll put my plugs here. Just a second. It helps.
It helps when you speak in this, right? Do you hear me? Do you hear me better? Do you hear me better?
We can see you, I can hear you, and se puoi sentire, forse sentite. Yes, we can. Please
Do you hear me now
continue.
or not? What?
Tu senti, no?
Some reason, anyway. What I wanted to ask,
Yes.
is that okay?
Let me switch from the PC to of Marco Pingaro.
Is that okay?
Che faccio? Io spengo qua.
Hello. Anyway, it doesn't matter.
I hope you can hear me. Do you hear me, Atrice? Do you hear me now?
Yes. Now, yes.
All right. So basically, the idea is this one. I said for the benefit of the conference of Patricia for a really, really good lecture on this part. But the question is really for everybody and maybe to have a deep think. So many of these theories, like Coursera theory and the non-local theory, is using so-called internal length of the model. And a colleague of mine that I replaced in Kashan when I came to Ecole Normale Supérieure is also one of the guys who really introduced his pioneering works on this non-local theory with Professor Bajan, because he did his PhD in Northwestern, and Professor Bajan, who was at that time one of the big names in this internal length type of. And he said that internal length for concrete should be something like three aggregate, you know, size. But given that concrete has a very different aggregate size, I never figured out which one aggregate does he mean. Is it small or is it bigger? You know. So basically, I know for you, you study a lot of masonry, which is kind of normal. And basically, how do you go about deciding when you go to computation? How do you decide internal length on the basis of what, really? What is the basic criteria for choosing the internal length? Did you hear my question? I don't hear you.
Adnan.
Yeah.
I will try to explain the hypothesis that I considered in the lecture of tomorrow.
Oh, okay.
Because I will present some examples of derivation of constitutive laws for different kind of materials, and of course it's a matter of hypothesis concerning
yeah.
the microstructure.
Right,
and
right.
You are right, and I have to also to introduce in my description the basic fundamental work of Bajant on these topics.
Yeah, but it's not criticism. Just this was my first exposure to this non-local theories coming from the guy I replaced, because for 1 year he was coming to Ecole Normale and we talked every time he was there. And then we talked science, but I became boss instead of him. I became a, what you call, responsable there, director of something. And then he had to explain to me what that means, you know, what I can sign, what I cannot sign. And then when we finished this administration, we would talk about science. And that's what he was trying to explain to me. And I really had the difficulties understanding, is it justified? Because, you know, And he says aggregate size, you have a famous MPAL Fourier recurves, aggregate could be big, could be small. So it really depends on what is the aggregate size. If you're in a nearby big aggregate, then your characteristic length is big. And if it's near small aggregate, it's small. So this is more like publicity for my lecture this afternoon, because I talk about probability. So even internal length has, to some extent, probability issue. That's what my feeling is. Maybe for masonry, it is a little bit better, because masonry bricks are built in a very modular way. But this is only talking about modern bricks. If you talk about bricks that you have, say, from Roman Empire times, then they have not had the same standards like us today. So again, you have kind of statistics and probability that has to enter the game. And this is really a little bit publicity for my lecture afternoon, because I do talk about probability. It doesn't come from me, the theory, but it comes from a friend of mine and colleague, Herman Matisse, who is an expert in mathematics, who did his PhD at MIT in Boston in USA with Gilbert Strang, famous math guy, and then worked for 20 years for Germanische Lloyd. This is a top insurance agency, and probability was used to say that they are not responsible, they don't have to pay the damage, you know. So basically really learned the probability a lot, and he knows how to teach this to engineers. I'll just try to convey this part a little bit of what Herman taught me in my lecture today. Anyway, and I put my, maybe do I have to put a tie or something, better jacket? I'm still in my pajama. I apologize for putting camera in pajamas, but what can you do? It's too hot in Rome not to have a canvas. Anyway, I thank you again. I'll listen to your lecture if I can tomorrow, so I'll get the answer better. But anyway, let these guys ask real questions. Patricia, see you in the afternoon. Bye-bye.
See you. Okay, thank you. Thank you very much for your participation.
Thanks
we
a lot.
Are honored of your participation and very glad of this.
Thanks a lot.
Bye. Are there any other question, observation by the audience? Mladen? Majid, I'm calling the people that I know directly. Meral, are you here? Non ci sono?
Yes, professor, I'm here.
Yeah. Meral, could you add something as anticipation of your lecture?
No.